Hey everybody, it's Mr. Allan, and I'm going to be walking you through how to use Inkarnate to make your sector map. So Inkarnate can be a wonderful tool for map making and battle map making, but we're going to go through this and choose one of those options that allows you to build a kind of a regional map. And remember that the map that you're going to build is for your sector, so do not make any assumptions about what's next to or adjacent to above or below your sector. The biggest and most important thing there is the choice of the map aspect ratio. So even if you don't want to use this format, you're going to be choosing a similar aspect ratio. So let's say that you prefer to draw your own maps in Photoshop, for example. That's totally fine as long as you use that aspect ratio and those settings. So here's my walkthrough. I basically start off with this, you know, more or less slightly rectangular squarish thing. I'm going to erase all the ocean because this demonstrational sector that I'm making is going to be a landlocked sector. So it's going to be presumably somewhere inside of one of the main continents. I like to leave a little water there, so I'm going to switch over to subtract, and I'm going to carve a way through and just create this sort of little river mini area and a delta that's going through it. I can change the size on that through there. And then it gives me, you know, a variety of different kind of little tributaries and rivers. You know, that's a fertile river delta, basically, where a river splits off. All right, zooming right along, I make this river. Then I'm going to carve out a chunk of lake with a couple little islands in there. Yep. And I don't really care if that's realistic or not. And then zooming forward, I can choose next what kind of land I want to do. So in my brain, I'm figuring that somewhere up there, I'm going to have some mountains. So I'm going to lay down like a kind of a gray base. And one of the things that you could do with Inkarnate is you can lay these down at like 100% opacity. So it's just like the straight up color. But you can also change the opacity and do some blending to make your textures look a little bit more realistic. I always like to kind of start off with the base textures in full, like 100%. So anything that is around water, I typically make more green because, you know, that's kind of how nature works. When you have water, the land around it is typically more fertile. So, and then I'll maybe go in and, you know, fill in areas. And I can always go back and take those things out if you don't like what you have. But this is kind of what I do. I put in my base areas as I want them. And then I can go back and change those textures to, you know, different things, and I can change the size and the opacity to do a little blending along the edges. So I might add in some brown in some areas, and that probably seems very stark right now, but again, I can go back over that with a lighter color or greater opacity, but it just kind of helps to differentiate these different areas within my land. And then we get into the stamps. And the stamps are really cool because this is where you can start adding in your real structure to your land. So I'm going to do mountains. And the way I do mountains is I always start from top of the screen, working my way to the bottom of the screen. And what this creates is a more realistic layering of the mountains. It's just kind of a basic map making technique. Like even if you do your maps by hand, always start with your top of the paper and work your way down. And it kind of covers up background to foreground. That's how you should think of it. You're working from the background in this kind of setting to the foreground. Sometimes you'll click on things and you'll find that they are not available to the free version. That's fine. But I can change, you know, to smaller mountains. I could add in these little things around the edges, you know, to make it kind of a little more realistic and blended. But again, you can do whatever you want, experiment, have fun. I like to add in some hills, you know, kind of thinking like as you come down from the mountains, it's still sort of hilly, but not quite completely insane. Then you can click and drag as well. So if you have a stamp that you really like, you can click and drag. And what that will do is it'll run through each of the options within a given stamp. So as I click and drag with those hills, for example, it'll run through however many options there are for hills. While I'm in this, I'm going to throw in a mine entrance here or there just because that might be a place where I want to have some adventure. So I'll put one in down there in the foothills, and then maybe another mine or two up in the mountainous area. And I could scale the size of the stamps to make them a little more realistic, right? Because I don't want the mine entrance being 5 miles wide. Now, don't always worry about the scale of your map, because some things might not be to scale on a map, and that's sort of legit anyway. All right, trees. Again, click and drag. As you do through that, it'll click and drag, and it'll populate wherever you're dragging across with whatever tree stamp you chose, right? So the deciduous trees, let's say. And then I can choose the pine trees and do the same thing and kind of mix and match, you know. And again, you know, you're limited by the free account to what stamps you have access to, but for most people, like, even the basic elements that are free are pretty good for this. So then I can go through and kind of, you know, blend it in a little better so it doesn't look like a tree farm, and add some trees down there, yep, along the river and the hills. Great, yep, perfect. I don't know, that might be enough for trees. Okay, so moving right along, now I could start working on like my towns and stuff. So before I drop towns, I might want to go into the grid. Okay, so I'm going to activate the grid. I'm going to turn that on, and you could see the grid lays this out, and it's the same grid layout as what you chose. And you could zoom in. If you click on the magnifying glass, you can zoom in and move around. That town is way too big, because if each one of those squares, for example, is 5 miles, that town, even if it's not to scale, would be still gigantically way too big. So I'm going to roughly put, you know, my scale so that this would be sort of believable, right? So, you know, if a village has like kind of a downtown part to it, plus it's got maybe, you know, some outlying farms and whatnot, it might be a few miles wide. You know, cities might be a little bit bigger, but basically you don't want your cities and towns to be like as big as a mountain, because that would be, you know, maybe sort of ridiculous. So I like to go through and choose a couple of each type. You might decide that maybe your area doesn't have any major cities at all. Maybe it has like one small settlement, you know, maybe it's like the wild frontiers of, you know, a land that's never been explored. And that's totally fine too. Feel free to use or not use whatever you want to make it fit your vibes. So I like to, you know, have some options here. Maybe I have some villages, some towns, some walled cities. I could add in other components, you know, just decoratively, like some windmills and a castle and some towers and that sort of thing, just to make it a little bit more interesting. Now, when you get to the point where you feel like you're at a good point, you like how everything's looking, you could change the grid color so that it's not like obnoxious. Like, I don't always go with the default black. Sometimes I change the grid color to something a little lighter so I could still see the grid, but it's not like kind of ruining the believability. Make sure that you save your project, and the format that I like you guys to save your files in would be something that indicates that this is your map. So just put in map, like the name of your land or your sector, and then your last name, so that we know who's submitting this. So after you save it, for sure, the next thing you're gonna wanna do is export it. So you're gonna go down to the bottom there and export, and you could see what the export settings are right there. Those export settings, that's the size of the file. So it's roughly a 2K file, which is, you know, better than just regular HD. So if you, again, if you don't wanna use Inkarnate and you would rather make your own map like on Photoshop or some other program, just make sure that it matches these settings right here, 2048 by 1536. That's what I'm gonna use to piece together the land. This has hopefully been helpful or informative. At the very least, it gives you an introduction to Inkarnate. We will see you at the next meeting.